knew that over a period of time, rather than trying to buy 2,000 cows or 1,000 cows with what money we have, it'll run us broke. So one of the suggestions from Mookie was a 2 to 5 year strategy of growing our own milking platform, or the cows that get milked on that platform should be Ngāi Tapu cows rather than hand-cooked cows, and they should also be a mixed variety which allows us to do beef as well, so we run a beef strategy on that farm as well. The processing and marketing is a long-term opportunity around us breeding Ngāi Tapu into that processing in international markets and local markets. It's also the ability for us to diversify our horticulture strategy out of Kaimomo, our Manuka strategy out of Kaimomo, onto the farm as well, and add to that tourism opportunities as we saw around the lakes, around people wanting to visit a farm and pet the cow, and do other weird things that people do when they haven't seen an animal before. It's also about feeding our own people in that space, and so we should be growing cattle for our marae, that if there is a hui, just simply shoot the cow, feed the people, and that reduces the cost of hui for people who want to come home and for things such as pinianga and stuff like that. So at the moment there is cadetships, which is usually through Land Corp, but it's starting with people who are straight out of school and looking to go to university. The farm employees are virtually employed by the farm manager as he sees fit, and there's no real criteria for that. Yeah, you don't need to bend down on the engi, the pictures in the front. And so the managers are also people who have gone through the Land Corp process. And a lot of them have been just people who have been employed by Mark Johnson, as people he knows, and he's grown them into the farm manager's role within a period of 3 to 4 years.
That's all the way.
It's really amazing.
It's only 3 years. Yeah, so we can get our own people in there now. You can go from milking cows, and this is an opportunity for all our young fellows over there or here, if they're fed up with what they're doing. It's not rocket science, honestly. It's the same thing year on year out, your initial year, spring, summer, autumn seasons, and then the next year, it's exactly the same thing again, and the year after that again. So after your initial 1 year cadetship, you'll do another year of theory and training as to why you're doing that, and get your head around what you've been doing for the last 2 years, and then you should be ready for a management training program into your third year. And the difference is, on farms of that scale, the amount of money that they generate, the people who I employ in the South Island and that, they come straight off a plane from the Philippines or Uruguay or Russia, places like that. They come over here, they start on a starting rate with no experience. We put them in $40,000 cash, $45,000 up to $49,000. They have accommodation, food, and training, agriculture, ITO, tech courses all throughout the year. We pay for them initially, and if they pass the courses or the levels that are set in front of them for that year, then we refund them money. So they're practically getting free scholarship. And these are guys that are just coming off the boat.
You just sit in our funnels down and
take the question. Well, yeah, I'd be happy to do that, brother, but you'll be going down there under my good name, and we really want to identify fellas that are going to do it. Otherwise, it's me that looks like shit. And I mean,
and we don't
really I did it myself, you know, and I've put all these foreigners through it. And what it does for them, their motivation is after that 3 year period, they're in a position as a pathway to full time citizenship because they're at that management level where they're an asset to the country. And so they get more and more points added to their visa. They turn up here on a 1 or 2 year working visa. Every certificate they gain, every level they pass in these education things, it goes towards points before their next visa. They can stretch it right out to a 5 year working visa. If they reach that middle management level, well, they are eligible to apply for citizenship.
And then they marry the local Māori lady.
Half of them already have.
They can.
Half of them are already really smart, overqualified to milk cows because they're free in interesting guys who come out of university and have just about full-blown vet degrees how to milk cows, bro. And these are the types of people that you, as I'm going to go down there and milk cows with this fellow, are competing with. This fellow's just done 6 years of university and he's nearly qualified vet, but he can't speak a word of English. That's when you get in.
So what we look at is, our strategy is about owning our own milk and beef cows and doing that over a 2 to 5 year program, which is about raising our own cattle. It's about progressing beyond the gate to processing and marketing, and that's value-added products. And it's also about that there's quite a lot of land out there we could use for other diversification business opportunities, feeding our own people, and I just put frontier issues up there because it's currently got a frontier contract for milk supply. But as Toby's talked about, there's a cadetship and training programs that are available, and there's the ability for us to get farm employees learning on that farm, and also a management regime that the ultimate goal is we're managing our sections of the farm with our own farm managers. So the iwi support into that space, or the future runanga support into that space, is to continue with the scholarships. The sponsorships may be related to ongoing farming training. Advocacy is about making it clear to the Sweetwater Farm that we have an employment strategy that they are required to meet, so any future employment opportunities from Dairy Unit 2 and Dairy Unit 3 must be through the Runanga program, which is us identifying who's interested in farming, and we are also investing into that space with scholarships and sponsorships and putting them to work in that particular place. And so it's also about linking to the Cradle to Career Tuku Education Strategy, which we talked about, which is the tertiary and university type of education components to agriculture. Okay, so any comments and thoughts around that strategy becoming part of our 20 years? So in the first 2 to 5 years, we're already thinking about where we want to be. And within the 20 years, God knows what it will look like, but at least we're on the path to making those things happen. I can then take that to Landcorp as part of their business planning strategy and saying, this is our strategy, how are you going to work with us to achieve these things for us? So it would be about identifying people's willingness to come home and milk cows, and also getting our local young people interested in farming as well. So it's not everybody's cup of tea, but
well, you start at milking cows, yeah? But the potential pathway and what would motivate people to get involved is right. We can start you off on 40,000 the first year, you might go to 49. The second year, the third year, is 60 to 100K, depending on the numbers, cow numbers and profit. But this is just what we can offer you. Between 60,000 to 70,000 in 3 years. But then out in the private sector, with experience of managing large herds like that, you can go out there and demand from people with farms that large that you know how to run this thing, and you're on 100K plus. Because you know how much money that these cows can make for you, and you know how to feed them. So a smart fellow will get in there, 4 to 5 years, Barry, you can get yourself up to 100K, which is a good earn for New Zealand, without a university degree.
As a child growing up, going to school and that, like, and not experiencing the whole farming stuff, like, how would you know farming was your forte?
Get in and have a go, bro. Just get in and have a go. Well, if you've got kids to feed and a mortgage to pay, you'll apply yourself. You'll find a way, bro.
Yes.
I mean, it's not an enjoyable experience waking up at 3:30 every morning, but hey, you got to do it.
So maybe a farm sort of a experience, because then...
Well, I won't kid you, it's no holiday, but there's benefits.
Well, they don't have a lot of options up here.
But there is a goal. It's up to you whether you want to achieve these goals to hit every year, because this is how the business will work. We will set you targets quarterly to hit, and you start hitting these targets, well then we've got no choice, we've got to keep pushing you up.
They have a problem employing people up here on the farms because choose where you want to be. It's not just go to the farm because there's a job. If you're not interested in farming, don't even apply. So it's for people who are really smart and say, yeah, I want to give this a go. I'm committed to it because there's an investment for us to make sure that they do that and not waste our time. And so I don't want to be giving someone a scholarship for farming and they decide they don't want to do farming after 6 months.
But that can be part of the education. You just say, there's school out there for the days. You know, that'll sort
well,
them out.
Yeah, you start finding and start identifying them young, who has an interest in there. And even if we could get into the education department there to set up some sort of farming skill thing as a skill for these kids in schools.
Doing a part of work experience.
Yeah, work experience. And not everyone's going to love it, and some kids are brought up on farms.
Mature form 1 and form 2, take them down and do it.
But the reality is we also need to, it's not about young people, it's all about unemployed people as well, and families and kids. So we always tend to say, let's start teaching kids while they're still at school about employment. Let's take those who are unemployed now and do something with them whilst we grow the education components.
But the first fellow I ever worked with, he had his rules on his farm. It's a thing, it's like a fishing boat. You're the captain, you run the ship. And straight away, he just told me, he goes, straight away, I don't employ anybody under the age of 30.
Exactly.
I don't employ anybody that doesn't have English as a first language, because I've employed all these types of people. And you wake up in the morning and they don't turn up to work and you go there and they've moved out in the middle of the night.
But that's why you can also say to say that have orientation.
Oh, and people over 30, preferably couples with kids.
Yeah, because you know they're stable.
They're going to stay there. I don't mind giving these fellas good housing, cheap rent, all the meat they can eat, all the milk they can drink. Because I know this fella's going to get up and he's going to come to work. And the minute he doesn't have a job, his wife's going to be kicking his ass to work. So, you know.
So I think the young talent stuff we can leave out at this stage, because I think everyone tends to start there. And I know that Tarara, for example, took a school out there and measured their success about the future of farming, because there were some happy kids who said they want to be farmers.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
You know, like, oh, is that really real? Everyone wants to be a fireman or a policeman. The reality is we've got to run a business and we need to employ people now rather than wait
10 years.
It's like we've been here for so long.
I don't like farming, but
bring on those million cows.
What are you saying, babe? What size gun did you wear?
Not the current employee, but perhaps start with those seriously interested in a farming career.
Just the
we've never gone out and asked who is seriously interested in farming.
Mum.
Hey, bro, it's a good office. You
promote the office.
It's better up at least it don't snow up here, because you don't have to go out and mine the six to get your cows up here, bro. She's a hot kid.
Because the biggest problem they have on the farm is employing young people. That's their reality.
Yeah.
They've employed 14 over the last period of time on cadet ships and no one has survived.
Yeah, well, it's a high staff turnover rate when you're dealing with fellows who don't
know. I think our view is looking at who is seriously interested and whether they're committed to that. And it's like you said, it's an older generation who have got kids, who have got responsibilities, and who need a job to pay.
Well, it's that whole lifestyle as well. You get a house and you get a farm, you know. So you can throw in extra things there, you get meat, you get, you know.
But you know, it's better having some opportunity than none.
Well, look at
the alternatives. Okay, so we agree that this strategy is a good place to start, with a view that we expand it as we go beyond.